Hey everybody, welcome back again to Ken Tamplin Vocal Academy, where the proof is in the singing. I'm continuing my isolated vocal series, and next up is Pat Benatar. The song is called Fire and Ice. If you wouldn't mind, please like and subscribe to my channel, that would be really cool. And I just want to dive right in. So here's Pat, and here's a solo vocal, and I do have an instrumental track of it too, so I might mix and match a bit as we go, but let's just check it out. Here we go.
Ooh, you're giving me the fever tonight. I don't want to give in. I've been playing with fire. You forget I've seen you work before. Take them straight to the top. Leave them crying for more. I've seen you burn them before. Fire and ice.
Now, it's really cool to know back then. By the way, I think this was recorded like at Mama Joe's recording studio. I've done one record there and some other recordings. I did a Magdalene tracking album of my Magdalene record in the same studio. In fact, I sang in her same microphone. anyway, but I bring it up because there's no auto-tune, zero auto-tune. You can hear that most of the takes are contiguous, if not all of them. I haven't dissected it and scrutinized it that much, but, and she's spot on her pitch. She's got really great emotion on the front side, and she's one of the very few female rock vocalists that integrated that really nice distorted sound, but not in such a throaty way like a Janis Joplin or something where it sounds really constricted. She's very, very operatic in her approach, which I really, really love, and she's said that many times. So you can hear really good support, you can hear a really good command of her vowels, everything is just very class A, and I just gotta say that. So let's continue, here we go.
You come on like a flame, then you turn a cold shoulder. You just take a little piece of my heart. You'll just tear it apart.
Now, did you notice that the vowels were really, fire and I, really tubular. So she's employing a lot of what I've talked to you guys a lot about bringing old bel canto, old operatic appoggio style of singing into rock music, because that's how you maintain good vocal health, and that's how you have that freedom in the sound. If you notice when she's distorting her sound, she doesn't sound like a donkey on the edge. She's got a lot of freedom in the sound, which is really cool. Let's continue. Here we go.
Moving in for the kill tonight. You got every advantage when they put out the lights. It's not so pretty when it fades away, 'cause it's just an illusion in this passion play.
Now, before we go on, she does sometimes use a raised laryngeal position. Passion play, I've seen you burn them before. So she's raising her larynx. Not the safest thing to do, but it's her style, and she's able to manipulate the laryngeal position over and over again. You hear her doing it, especially when she gets to the ah vowel, but it's cool and it's Pat. She also sounds really young here, so you can tell she's in her 20s. She's got that really nice young, sobrée, young, agile, just very kind of loose, fresh kind of sound. Anyway, all right, let's continue. Here we go.
I've seen you burn on me fire. You come on like a flame.
By the way, hear that little just before she swallows, just before this, check it out.
Ice. You come on like a flame, then you turn a cold shoulder, fire and ice. I wanna give you my love, but you just take a little piece of my heart.
Now, I believe, personally, that Lizzie Hale has modeled a good chunk of her singing style after this and has taken it up a couple notches in the throat department. do I think Lizzie has the same finesse as Pat? No. Do I think Lizzie can sing a ballad like Pat? No. I don't think, Shadows of the Night or any of those kinds of songs. I don't think that Lizzie could handle the sweetness of the sound, because Lizzie's forced her sound so much that she has to always go to a forced state to get somewhere. And when she backs off the sentence, it doesn't have the same sweetness or agility that Pat does. But you can really hear a lot of Lizzie Hale's influence, I believe, in her approach to this. And I think that's quite interesting. So let's continue. Here we go.
So you think you got it all figured out. You're an expert in the field without a doubt. But I know your methods inside and out. And I won't be taken in by fire and ice.
Cool. Now, the only other time other than, there's a couple pieces like Hell is for Children. There's a couple Benatar tunes where she employs this kind of distortion. She doesn't use it that much, but when she does a fantastic job. Now, I wanna just go to the top here, and I want to bring in just the rhythm for a second. So you can hear it's not the band giving Pat all of her energy. We've talked about that before in other tracks where the band brings a lot of the energy, and it sounds like the singer's not quite... And it isn't singing as hard as we remembered because the track does so much work for them. But that's not true here. Check this out.
Oh, you're giving me the fever tonight. I don't wanna give in. I've been playing with fire.
See what I mean? So she's got that part. And then when you get to the bridge, here we go. Hold on. Now, another thing that was really interesting about Pat back here in the day is that a lot of people use different recording techniques, and that's cool. But one of the things that's cool about Pat is she didn't soak or drench her sounds in reverb. Now, if you listen to like Boston One, or you listen to a lot of even Zeppelin stuff, you know, you listen to early stuff, they just are absolutely drenched in reverb. Her mixes are really clean and a lot of just room sounds and natural tones. That's true for the instruments too. So it brought a real fresh sound to a rock crowd. I forget how many Grammys she won, but she at one time she held more Grammys than any woman vocalist alive, I think. But I say that because I really appreciate the freshness of the sound. So okay, here's the next section. We heard this.
Moving in for the kill tonight. You got every advantage when they put out the light.
Yeah, she's still able. Every advantage when they put out the light. She can stay real soft on the sound and then wham, lean right into it. And then come back, you know, she can diminuate her piano, come back as a piano sort of sound, and then really crescendo and on some of the bigger stuff. So let's continue on. I'm going to get past the... guitar solo. Hey, Neil Giraldo, all these big guitar solos. That was fun back then. They don't really get to do that much these days.
Fire and ice. You come on like a flame, then you turn a cold shoulder. Fire and ice. I want to give you my love, but you just take a little piece of my heart.
Now, another really cool thing is if you notice... I remember, and maybe we remember things differently, but I thought the backgrounds were bigger, and that was another thing that happened a lot with these bands back in this era, is they would stack a lot of vocals and make the backgrounds really big. Well, her sound is so big, she's just doing a simple two-part harmony there, and I just remember it sounding monstrously large or bigger, whatever that phrase would be. Anyway, and so here, though, it's really not that way, but when you put the track in, you can see how that happens. Because it just works. Check it out.
Fire and ice. You come on like a flame, then you turn a cold shoulder. Fire and ice. I wanna get...
Right? So we get this illusion of a bigger sound. Oh, it is a big sound, but like stacked vocals, and it's not. So let's move forward here.
You come on like a flame, then you turn a cold shoulder. You just take a little piece of my heart.
By the way, and they're really pristine, exact. There's no hangover or nothing. I mean, she was just really, really pristine and spot on in the way she did her backgrounds. It's really cool.
You come on like a flame, then you turn a cold shoulder, fire and ice. You come on like a flame, then you turn a cold shoulder, fire and ice.
you never get the feeling that she's hit her ceiling, right? You never get the feeling she's at the threshold of the top of her range, because she's not. And so you can really hear the tiger in her tank. She's a little thing, you know, 5'3" or 5 or something. I'd be 5'7". I think she's 5'5". She's a really tiny little thing, kind of like Dio, the Dio of women's voice back then. So I love the fact that you just hear really great even compression, you know, in the throat because of diaphragmatic support and just her ability to manipulate it. It's good stuff, man. This is what we teach here. I have all my students, when I talk to my students, we refer to stuff like this so that they can really understand really good control. So anyway, thank you, gang. Hopefully you enjoy this. I have more Pat Benatar coming your way and more of a lot of these coming your way. So stick around for my next video.